Good morning.
Good morning.
If you would join me in the call to worship, please. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I feel no fear, no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for my whole life long.
Let us worship God. Christ is the door by which we enter your new order, O God. He is the source of our comfort and the anchor of our faith. Through him, you have shown us the way unto the land of your promise, where peace is eternal and grace has no bounds. As we enter the courts of your sanctuary, may we know that you are with us and give you all the honor due to your glorious name. Please stand and join us for hymn number 63. Join me in the Litany of Assurance. When you do right and suffer it patiently, you have God's approval.
We are healed by Christ's wounds.
For to this you have been called, that you should follow in Christ's step.
We are healed by Christ's wounds.
He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness.
We are healed by Christ's wounds.
For you were straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls.
We are healed by Christ's wounds.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want.
We are healed by Christ's wounds.
The peace of God be with you.
And also with you.
Please say hello to your neighbor.
Thank you. Thank you, choir. I'd like to invite Sunday School to come forward. Come on down. While they're coming forward, just a couple of quick announcements. We will be recognizing all of our graduating seniors, both high school and college, on May 21st. So that's three weeks from now. We're asking that if you have a little write-up or something you'd like us to know about your graduate or about yourself, if you are the graduate, please have it to the office by May 14th. And then the other thing is Sunday School. The last day of Sunday School will be June 6th. And these beautiful children today are going to learn that they are serving lunch that day. So these children will be serving you lunch as a thank you for all you've done for them and the support you've shown them in their Sunday School this year. So please come that week. We will be honoring our Sunday School kids, and they in return will be honoring you. And Steve will be helping cook. So you don't want to miss this. Steve will be cooking. I figured I'd tell him in front of y'all. Gives them an hour to think about it. We in Sunday School have been intensively studying the life of Moses. And we picked Moses to study in Sunday School because Moses is such an important figure, both in the Old Testament and moving on into the New Testament, and the impact and the things we see about Moses in the New Testament. We didn't talk about Moses in the New Testament, but we did follow the life of Moses from birth in the wicker basket in the river all the way up to the Battle of Jericho. We finished the Battle of Jericho last week, and we got to see this broad range of experiences that the people of Israel had with their God. And I thought it was really important that we do the whole story and not pick it apart and do just this piece, just the Ten Commandments, or just do the Battle of Jericho, but do the whole thing, because there's a lot to that story, to that adventure, to that historical event in the life of God's people. And sometimes in life we have a tendency to look at just a snapshot, to look at one thing. Maybe you're looking at Facebook and you see one picture of somebody's life. Or maybe you're looking at Instagram and you see one post about somebody's life, or you read one tweet about somebody's life, or you see one TikTok video that someone has posted. And it's easy to forget that these people who post these things are part of a larger story, that they don't exist as just one post, that there is a before that post in their lives and there's an after a post in their lives. And it's easy for us to look at that one post and to pass judgment and decide the kind of people that they are, and to decide what they believe and how we should treat them. It's important in life to remember that when we encounter somebody, we are encountering them in a moment, that they have a life before that moment and they have a life after that moment. And it's important that we remember that people are more than the moments in which we encounter them, more than the post, and the Bible is more than the verse. You can read a verse in the Bible, but we have to remember that there's a whole bunch of stuff before and after, which is why we come to Sunday School, which is why we come to church, so we can study the big picture. So we take that lesson of studying the big picture and go forth and apply it to people. Remember that they're part of a big picture too, and treat them as such. Let us pray. Lord, we are so grateful that you are so much more than a moment, and that moment to moment you are with us, guiding us, walking with us, upholding us, and making us the people you would have us be. Help us to go forth from this place renewed and with vigor and with energy to spread your word and to share your love. In your name we pray. Amen.
Happy birthday to you. first, don't feel bad for Steve. The NFL draft was this weekend, and it was held in Kansas City, and there was a nauseating amount of talk about how Kansas City won the Super Bowl. They brought the three Super Bowl trophies out on stage. They won over the course of their franchise. It was a sea of red. So I don't feel bad for him at all. Not one bit. Second thing is we have our hymn after the sermon is going to be Abide With Me. We decided to make a change, and that's 642, Abide With Me. Okay, announcements out of the way. Here we go. Our first scripture text today comes from Acts 2, verse 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship and the breaking of the bread and their prayers. Awe came upon everyone because of the many wonders and signs being done by the apostles. All who believed were together and had all things in common. They would sell their possessions and give goods and distribute and proceeds to all as any had need. Day by day, as they spent much time together in the temple, they broke bread at their homes and ate their food and with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having the goodwill of all the people. And day by day, the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. Our second scripture text today from the New Testament comes from 1 Peter chapter 2, starting at verse 19. There we go. First Peter chapter 2, starting at verse 19. For it is to your credit if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you should follow in his footsteps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that free from sins we might live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. Our gospel text today comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 10, starting at verse 1. Very truly I tell you, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs up by another way is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name, and he leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not recognize the stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again, Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me were thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved, and I will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." Nights ago, Melissa and I watched a very interesting documentary called Free Solo. And if you don't know what that is, it is a documentary about a man by the name of Alex Holland. And if you don't know who he is, he's kind of like the Michael Jordan of mountain climbing. He is not only a great climber when he climbs with other individuals, he's not only a great climber when he climbs solo with the ropes and the hammers and the pitons, but he also climbs another way. They call it free solo, where you climb without the ropes and the pitons and the hammers, and it's just you and the rock. Now, he had made several great solo climbs, but he wanted to do something that no one had ever done. And so he wanted to do a free solo climb of El Capitan in Yosemite. And that is a granite outcrop of rock that's about 3,200 feet from base to the top. And it's a pretty sheer cliff all the way up. And so he set out to do this. There had been some individuals who had tried this. Some of the great stars in free solo climbing before him had tried this and failed. And of course they died, because when you fail in free soloing, you die. And so it seemed like a crazy thing to do, and it probably was. But as the documentary showed, he took a lot of time planning out what he was going to do. He went through a lot of preparation. He climbed the route several times, and he made markings about where his hand positionings would be, where his foot positionings would need to be if he wanted to make this climb free solo. And then he made extensive notes in his journal so that he could go over it each night. He prepared both physically and mentally. He did just about everything you could. It was still a crazy idea, but he planned and prepared about as much as possible to make it up that mountain. And of course, since the movie came out, he did indeed do that, and nobody has done it since. In our scripture text today from 1 Peter, the last few weeks we have been going through portions of scripture in 1 Peter. And Peter has been building an argument over the last few weeks. It starts with Peter telling us that we are exiles in this world. This is his first point that he makes in his argument. He says, we are exiles in this world. And Peter's telling us not to get too caught up in this world that we forget that on the other side of this world is an eternity. And how we prepare here and now will determine to a large extent what that eternity is going to be like. And so the first thing Peter reminds us is that we are in exile here. This is not our home. This is only a short portion of our entire existence. And we need to remember that. The next building block in his argument is Peter reminds us that we are sinners, that we have fallen short of the glory of God, and that there's no way we can make that right. There's no way we can atone for what we have done. And in fact, even if we could atone, we're still going to sin on the other side of that. And so Peter, in the last few weeks, has been making the argument that not only are we sinners, but we are unable to save ourselves, and we in fact need a Savior. And then finally, he ends with his last point, which is to introduce individuals to Jesus. He points to Jesus and he says, here is an individual who can forgive your sins. And clearly that's something we want. We would like to be friends with the one who has the power to forgive our sins when we appear before God in the next life to be judged by what we have done. And Peter says, here is this Jesus. Not only can he forgive your sins, but he has the power over life and death itself. Figuratively speaking, he holds it in his hand, because he and he alone was someone who raised a body, not just back to life, but transformed it into a spiritual body, an everlasting body. Peter introduces the individual to Jesus Christ, and he says, as you're on that other side in eternity, wouldn't it be good to know somebody who can provide for you in that eternity? And so eventually, Peter ends his argument for Jesus by telling us he is the shepherd of our souls, not just our physical bodies in this world. Peter would say, yes, he is the shepherd of us here and now, but he is the shepherd of our souls. Our souls existed long before we came to this world, long before this world existed. And Peter says, even then, he was the shepherd of us. And our souls will exist long after this world passes away. And Peter says, yes, even in those times, he is the shepherd. He's not just the shepherd of us, he is the shepherd of our souls. Now, today in the Western world, the message of Christianity is not having the success it has in the past. And in large reason, that is because we have record numbers of people today who believe this is all that there is to existence. There is nothing beyond this life. And indeed, if you are convinced that there's nothing beyond this life, then what does Jesus Christ actually offer you? Maybe he's a good teacher, but certainly he can't offer you eternal life. Another thing that's happening today is for those who do believe there's something on the other side of death, that there is a life beyond that, they don't believe that they're sinners, or if they're sinners, they can put it right themselves. And so once again, if we believe that we are either not sinners or that we can put it right ourselves, then why would we need Jesus Christ? Why would we need a Savior? Why would we need someone who can put everything right? But if we believe Peter's argument, if we believe that there's something beyond this world and eternity awaiting us, and if we believe that we are sinners and we cannot stand ourselves before God, sinless before God, then Peter says there is an answer, and that is in Jesus Christ. In our gospel text today, Jesus makes a very inflammatory statement. He tells the crowd, not only is he the good shepherd, but he says, all that came before me were thieves and robbers. Now, some commentators try to explain that away by saying, well, just look what happened prior in John's gospel to this passage. Jesus healed a man who had been born blind. And at first he's brought in by the religious leaders and they examine him, and then he's thrown out. And then they pull him in again to examine him a second time, and then again they throw him out and ban him from the synagogue. Jesus finds him and reveals himself to him, and it says the man worshiped him. And then the Pharisees, because they're always around, heard Jesus say to this man, "For this I came to the world, so that those who were blind could see, and those who could see would become blind." And the Pharisees started arguing, "Jesus, are we blind then? Are you saying we're blind?" And basically Jesus said, "Yes. Yes, you're not only blind, but it's really bad because you're blind, and yet you say you can see." And so the interpreters say that when Jesus is talking about all that came before me were thieves and robbers, he's talking about the religious leaders. And I think they're partially correct. They're the ones who interpret it this way. Jesus is clearly talking about the religious leaders, but I don't think Jesus is just talking about them. I think he's making a very exclusive claim here about being the good shepherd, and he means it when he says, all who came before me are thieves and robbers. And that means great prophets such as Moses and Elijah and Samuel. And that means great teachers such as Buddha or Lao Tzu, the founder of Taoism, or Plato or Socrates. I think Jesus is making a very exclusive claim, and he is including all the teachers who came before him. Now, making this claim, he's not saying there were no good teachers who came before him. Obviously, he knows that there were good prophets before him. And obviously, he knows there were good teachers, honest individuals who were trying to help people, not exploit them. But he still makes this exclusive claim that, compared to me, they are all like thieves and robbers. Now, what does he mean by that? Well, again, if we go back to Peter's argument, and if we understand Peter's argument, and if we accept Peter's argument, suddenly it makes sense. Because none of those teachers can help us with what comes after this world. None of them have the power of life and death in their hand. None of them can grant us eternal life. And in fairness to them, none of them ever claimed they could. None of the prophets ever claimed this, nor did Buddha, nor did Lao Tzu, nor did Plato or Socrates, or any of the great teachers. None of them claimed that they could grant us eternal life. And so, according to Jesus, who can grant us eternal life, indeed, they are like thieves and robbers. Not only that, but Jesus claims that he is the one who can forgive our sins, a very exclusive claim. He's the one who can deliver us before that judgment seat of God, being pure and innocent and sinless. And only he can do it. And again, in fairness to all the other prophets and teachers, none of the others ever claimed that they could do such a thing. None of them ever claimed they could set your relationship right with God. But Jesus claims he can. And so compared to all the rest who came before him, they are thieves and robbers, because none of them can set us right with God like Jesus can. And then as we enter into eternal life, wouldn't it be nice to be friends with someone who could provide for us for that eternity? John sees in his visions of heaven Jesus being the good shepherd who leads us to the tree of life so that we can have eternal life, who leads us to streams of living water so we're always in relationship with the Lord God Almighty. Wouldn't it be helpful to have someone on the other side, that eternity, who could provide for us, who could wipe away all our tears, who could set things right? It is within these claims that Jesus is making about himself that he talks about all these other individuals being thieves and robbers. And indeed, from that perspective, they are all thieves and robbers. And so the question comes down, do we accept Peter's argument? Do we believe that there is something beyond this world? And do we believe that we are sinners who have fallen short of the glory of God, who cannot put themselves right, who need a Savior, who need someone to intercede with them, with the Lord God Almighty, who need them to deliver them pure and innocent before that judgment seat? Do we believe that? And do we believe that we need someone to help us with the eternity that waits us, to provide for us, to take care of us, to shepherd us, as he says? Do we believe these things? If we do, there is only one individual who claims to be able to do all these things, and that is the Good Shepherd, Jesus Christ. And so it comes down to the fact that, do we believe Peter's argument as he's laid it out or not? Let us pray. Lord God, we are so thankful that you have come and that you have taught us all the things that you have in Scripture. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Join me in the the Apostles' Creed, our affirmation of faith in the bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. Any announcements? We have a prayer request.
Saturday, May 6th is the college students' graduating ceremony. And Saturday, the 6th at 11 at Taffy Apple Arena there in Wilson. And everyone is invited. This is one of the biggest ceremonies after the pandemic that is open to the public. And I am one of the graduating
students. Any other announcements?
Right here.
Yes.
Please keep the Hornstra family.
Yes.
What?
Any other prayer requests?
Yes, Mark. Everybody look this way, right? I'd also like to lift up a friend. His name is Ryan. He just needs the guidance of God in his life.
Ryan.
We all do.
Ryan. Anyone else? Let us gather together as God's people in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we are thankful that we can come before you and that we can open our hearts to you and our minds. We thank you, Lord God, that you know everything that we have done, everything that we are, everything that we will be, everything that we're going to be after you have transformed us in ways that we can't even imagine. We thank you, Lord God, that you have called each of us to this destiny where you take who we are and you will make us even more beautiful. And they will indeed put us right and fix the things that are wrong with us. We thank you that this is a promise that you have made to us long ago in the prophets. We thank you that it is a promise that you sealed by having your Son die on the cross, being nailed to it, nailing our sins and destroying them on that day. And we thank you for the good news that you gave us in his resurrection, that you are still alive and that you love us so deeply. We pray, Lord God, that you will bless us with your Spirit and enable us to be the servants that you call us to be. We pray, Lord God, that you'll help us and bless us as a church and a congregation to reach out with the message that you have given us to share with the world. We also pray, Lord God, for the churches in our community and throughout our world and our nation, that you will bless them with your Spirit, calling individuals, calling your children, so that helping them to hear your voice. We also pray this day, Lord God, for those that we know are going through difficulties. We pray for Dale Hornstra and his family. We pray for Ryan. We pray for Emily and all those we know need help. And now let's take a few moments to pray for those we're concerned about. Lord Lord God, we thank you for hearing our prayers for others. And now let us pray the prayer our Lord and Savior taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Join me in the prayer of dedication. We hear the voice of Jesus, the shepherd, O God, and seek to follow his course for our lives. We bring our gifts now before you as a result of our search. Accept them and use them so that others may join in the quest. Bring others to the gates of your promised land and let them hear you calling them to come. Enter in. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Amen.